looking at sequences, so you're almost looking at videos of your typeface, and you see if all the translations work well, if the flow translates well. So yeah, that kind of the whole project, I think, had like a couple of months of just proofing the variable animations in it, which is kind of something we never had to do. So I kind of made this meme for Erkin afterwards, kind of bring him back to life. Yeah, having Elias with me today is super nice, not only because he's my best guide in the town, but also because he developed afterwards, or has been working with us for a long time on many core projects, and also has published our last, or like has designed our last published font called Arizona. And I think you will talk about this now.
Thanks, Johannes. So as Johannes just said, I'm Elias, and I just wanted to quickly introduce myself. I was was born in Vienna, actually, and lived in Berlin for the eight last years, studying at the UdK, and there I met Johannes. And since 2016, I'm always part of the Dynamo crew, and was working as a collaborator in the project, but also keeping my own design practice, which gave me a lot of opportunities, actually, working with Dynamo like this. And yeah, be able to work on this rather massive variable font since 2018, so the last 3 to 4 years. And it actually started all in It started actually in Lago di Como, where the Dynamo team had trip in summer, and this was actually the time when variable fonts were introduced to the web, so they could be implemented in websites, and that really kicked things off. And type designers around the world were really like excited about this new technology, and this is where we also came up with the idea for Arizona. As Johannes said before, there's several ways to approach this new tool. There is this conventional approach that lets you manipulate the weight, the italic or the width axis, or maybe the x height. These are like the very like reasonable and economic ways of approaching variable typefaces, but there is more in it than the eye could see at first. So, for example, with white, We introduced the inkjet version, where the inkjet itself becomes variable, or we did a mono axis on several typefaces now that lets you create a semi-mono, for example, that before that probably no one would have thought about. And yeah, and bringing this thing further, we were thinking about maybe this is the moment in time where we could introduce this scandalous new axis, the Serif to Sans axis. And is it starting? Yeah. And this is a visualization of the A changing between the genres. So it's kind of bending the genres and implementing various stylistic genres into one typeface. And this typeface was called Arizona because it was the name came up because it was made from an early sketch of Tom Carnes, who worked with Lubelin, and he's residing in Arizona now. That's a little side story. Now it animates. Okay. So yeah. It was challenging because the points within the letters, they had to be the exact same. So one point has to move to another point. We already had this in the workshop today, and we continue tomorrow. But this is basically what the construction of the letter G looks like. And this way of designing had its restrictions, but also gave way to the form Arizona became in the end. And Arizona also comes with a weight axis, And it that includes the styles thin, light, regular, medium, and bold, and all the ones between. Is it already animating? Sorry. And already has and also has an italic axis. And on the italic axis, some weird things are also happening, like the serif, the left serif from the Y is like bending downwards, or the verticals of the F are staying the same. And once you designed extremes like the sun, we will discuss this tomorrow, but it's basically an interpolation that if you design a typeface with a thin version and a bold version, you can interpolate between them and create a light version, a regular version, and a medium, basically. And if you do this on another axis, you create different in-between steps. So you have one version that has like really small serifs that are already just started to grow. Then you have like a medium serif that is a 50% mix between those two extremes. And then it goes more and more up to the serif version of the typeface. And yeah, this is also a way how to come up with new typefaces that are purely created out of this. And so Arizona comes in 5 different subfamilies: the Arizona Sans, Arizona Flair, which is the very like small serif one, Arizona Mix, Arizona Text, and Arizona Serif. Yeah, this is like an insight of how the studio session looked like when we were working on it.
Love distraction.
Yeah, a lot of distraction. By Dan Solbach, who's standing here and eating in my ear. And then we also do a lot of iPad proofing. So we started really like to not print so much out anymore, but rather proofing on the iPad, because you can like really zoom in really nicely. And yeah, the way here you see like 3 words, and they had to be so much different, because they're completely different styles, but in a way they have to stay somehow homogeneous between each other and really work kind of like they are one family, but still be different in itself. And this was a really like a pain somehow. You see me here working, struggling, and then in the end it kind of worked. We're really happy with the result. Yeah, and one of the first applications of Arizona Typeface was actually an early version of it, where we did the custom version of the typeface that goes really like condensed. We did this with This Is Collins for the San Francisco Symphony. And this is just another example of a very fond application, because this thing reacts to sound, and which fits perfectly for the symphony in San Francisco. And what's nice about is our programmer and type developer, Rob, he developed this tool for them to create with the variable fonts kind of like logo marks or headlines. So this is a plugin for InDesign, and he wrote this as an addition to the typeface itself. Yeah, and talking about Rob, you will continue now with his newest thing.
Okay, maybe I've caught my breath meanwhile. Yeah, so now we also want to show you a couple of like ongoing developments, things that aren't published yet. Later on, I will also talk about basically Foundry, what it means to run a Foundry, I guess. Like Gravity, for instance, is an example. It's a typeface we've been working on a lot during the last year. Rob, mostly, like, it's basically his baby. And now we're having it on hold, and we're kind of waiting for the right moment to publish it. I think as we like a small team, each design is also often a reaction to the things we have been working on before or helped each other out with. So I think also Rob was kind of thinking about what would be his exploration now. Like Elias did the Sans with Serif. I don't think anyone else will do this after him or would be able to do it. And then I think, Rob was kind of thinking about exploring widths. So not talking about weights, for instance, or not talking about italics, but really thinking, what can I do if my own kind of, you know, task is, or like if my challenge that I pose myself is making the widest and the most condensed kind of design space. So out came gravity, and it has 12 different widths. So we go from also a naming challenge in a way. We go from X, 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 X compressed on the very top to wide. Again, like with any font, but also here, you're basically working on different subgenres of your font. So you have to work, like the wide type of style needs a certain treatment, or certain type of drawing, or the curves need a certain type of touch. Normal one, which is maybe another benchmark, the fourth from the bottom. You know, the curves are a bit less smooth, like in the white, it gets already a bit more compressed, so you have to draw that in a certain way and so forth, kind of reach the XXXX compressed, which is really like the kind of the tightest you can draw and the strictest also. No, it's good. Here, like, proofing is important, so that's also something we try to improve the proofing. Like, how do we look at all that work, and how do we share it so we can feedback each other? So by now we have a almost purely digital workflow. So we make PDFs, and then kind of send them around, and then people can mark the comments on using an iPad, mostly. At the bottom, or here, you can see like an outline sketch we did, also kind of an exploded outline. Maybe something we're gonna do now in the next weeks. Yeah, and here you can see some outtakes again from the proofing, and that's just comments that the whole team kind of contributes to, and then Rob would kind of implement them and send around a new proof. And it's important to kind of structure it a little bit, like thinking, okay, this is more about punctuation, so we look at commas, quotes, how the whole sentence works. This one is about numbers and additional stuff. Always nice to see like a green check. Means that it's good. Yeah, and also here, gravity, I mean the name, I love kind of cheesy names. Let's see. Yeah. Oh, it's a reload. Interesting. Doesn't do the hole, huh? Okay, I think my laptop is suffering a little bit. You would see like a video of the G being like super wide and super compressed on the other end. Maybe later. Again, some outtakes. I think it's also important that whatever you find on that spectrum can also just be used at its own individual style, of course. Like, no one has to necessarily use it all or has to use it in this way. But you can also just use that if you need like a strong kind of titling typeface. Here, first and second row, already mixing two widths, a bit more narrow, a bit more wide. More extreme example. Here as well. So the idea being kind of create this powerful titling tool, which you can make a, you know, Quentin Tarantino-like poster with. That's Rob. Rob is a scaringly good chess player, kind of humiliating. I had the idea to introduce to buy a chess board and kind of regret it. Let's see if this one works. Yeah. Ooh. That's sad. I don't know what's happening. That's also interesting. So I think you can always think of features or like alternate stuff that you can add or implement into the font. So with gravity, we thought, you know, this whole idea of jumping or expanding could also be pushed a bit further, like characters can jump up and down. And we kind of split it into different character groups, like either only the characters like the G, P, and Y that go below the baseline can kind of move up if you hit a certain button as a designer. You can also then raise only the lowercase characters so they kind of hang from the top. You can raise everything. You can just shorten the descenders here, like the Q. And then you can combine all these things. And I think that's when it gets really exciting. Like, you kind of work with the font as if you would work with wood type, you know, like you really kind of push stuff around. And then here the more classical alternates that we usually build a lot of those into the fonts because it's just richer. So alternate quotes, square punctuation. And I think it's kind of cool how much it actually changes the flavor of the sentence, just swapping the punctuation out. Yeah, and here you can see different kind of settings in action. Made a little meme for Rob. How wide can you go? And that's kind of the, yeah, I think the next font that we will publish, but maybe like in a month or so, I think, yeah, maybe Rob will fix some couple of things, or we kind of sharing it with friends first before it comes out. Then next chapter, which I find very, very exciting, is kind of maybe talking a little bit about the Foundry itself and the things that we've been learning, because yeah, Fabian and I are not really like business people, but eventually if you start, or like we kind of fell into it, first Dynamo would only publish our own work or like our own font, the first font for a long time. And then later on you kind of fall into it that you start to publish more, publish fonts from other people, and that all kind of, yeah, you kind of start a little publishing house basically with a lot of stuff that comes with it. So maybe I can share some things. Yeah, I really remember like first time we both lived in Berlin, Fabian and I. And I think we did like a whole bunch of projects, also freelance for other people a lot, Dutype. And I think it's a bit like the innocent years of Dynamo. But we had already decided that we would work together. But that was kind of a good thing. And then 2017, we won the Swiss Design Awards, which was super crazy for us. And it came with a lot of money also and recognition. Well, basically, we thought, okay, we can do this, makes sense. Other people like what we're doing. And it kind of was a bit of a changing point. So we would say maybe that 2017, we really started to, you know, put all the other work aside. We used the money that we won also to, you know, pay staff and finance our work coming from there. And we kind of realized a couple of things. So one being that maybe we want to work, or like actually it's a bit more complicated, because at that point, for instance, Fabian and I, we had our own typefaces. So we like had typefaces that we made together, and we had our own typefaces. And then what we realized that if you want to really work together as a team, the company needs to own the fonts and not the individuals. So we used the prize money for the company to buy the fonts. Kind of interesting thing, I think. And from then onwards, basically everything we do is 50-50. And we kind of concluded a couple of things. So we realized that we really enjoy having a team around us, like a lot of people, and work with everybody together. Then, yeah, it sounds simple, but we came to realize we make fonts and we publish the fonts, because it's kind of important for us. And then we also publish other people's fonts, and we also make fonts for others. That's using the words fonts a lot, but they're all different. And the fifth thing that we also kind of didn't want to kill is that we also like to make hardware. So we'll show that a bit later. But for instance, what it doesn't show is all the things that we don't do, right? So like maybe in the years leading up to that, we did a lot of stuff and rarely said no to anything. But on here, for instance, we don't really have graphic design anymore. So we don't offer graphic design as a service or something like that. So usually when things, jobs come around like identities or books, things that we really like doing actually, we kind of realized that if we want to do the Foundry and make fonts, we kind of have to say goodbye to that. So here, it's a lot of people we've been super blessed to work with. I won't call them out all one by one, but it's a lot of people who intern with us, freelancers, people who we collaborate with, people whose work we published, and a lot of people, or almost all of them, are kind of still in the larger family, even if they kind of started their own thing later on or work with us just part-time. Oh yeah, special effects. Put a lot of work into the special effects. Then our own work, the one I mentioned earlier, is basically here, like our Dropbox folders, like our type library. I think by now it actually grew a little bit, but that's kind of our library. That's a font that we have. Yeah, I think of it now as maybe, you know, running a book publishing house, and that's kind of our titles. And Favorite, for instance, one of our more popular fonts, has a lot of extensions. So it comes with Favorite and Favorite Extended, Favorite Mono, Favorite Lining. Like, we put a lot of time into that. The fourth point was we make fonts for other people. So basically, we always spend time with client work. So clients come to us, and we make fonts for them. So that's still not really published, actually, but we made the fonts for the Olympic Games and the Olympic Committee. This will launch basically this year in Tokyo. That was a crazy job. And we kind of made the new bespoke typeface for Remova, the suitcases, which also launched this year. So this is an example for custom clients. And that really comes with a different dynamic. So basically, when you work with your own fonts, then you're really like in your own little echo chamber. And when you work with a client, then you know you have to react to the client's context, and usually that's super interesting. So it's really something you want to do. But yeah, it's very different to working just for yourself. Yeah, then hardware is kind of the counterpart to software. So I think we really enjoy, you know, printing T-shirts or making hats or stuff like that, and usually it's connected to some event or some travel or trip or friends. So for instance, when we designed Favorite Hangul with Mingu together, we designed these like bucket hats, which are really typical in Korea, and you know, kind of accompanies the digital work. Business. See if I have a special effect. Not really. Yeah, I really enjoy talking about business, especially as a creative. I think you have to learn how to make money somehow. Otherwise, it's very difficult. And maybe I thought I would kind of share a couple of things about us. So yeah, Dynamo's revenue, if you want to say, or that's basically the money we make, comes out of these different revenue streams. So for us, I know that's different for other foundries, but we basically make most of our money by selling font licenses, opposed to making money by doing projects. Still, second is maybe projects. Then 10% is consultancy. So for instance, Instagram hired us to consult them on fonts, things like that. So that's maybe 10%. And then hardware, like the stuff we really love, teaching, being here, for instance, and you know, producing hats and toothbrushes and stuff, that's almost makes no money, but I don't think it's a surprise. Still important to us, but you know, if you break it down, it looks like that. When we distribute a font, that's kind of, imagine an artist being represented by a gallery, and our deal is 50-50, so that means the artist gets 50% of a sale and we get the other 50, and then the tasks are basically split in the artist making the font, like Elias designing Arizona. That's all his kind of responsibility. And from that point onwards, we kind of take care of everything else, like whatever might happen once you put something out. What's really interesting here is also that we started to look more into our data. I mean, that's not really something that's kind of natural for us, I would say, but working with Vanessa and Rhea, they both do our accounting and kind of business kind of analytics, I would say. We kind of started to look more at, like, you know, they make us these like super interesting statistics. And we kind of started to look at that and try to like take cues from that. This is kind of the one that I actually showed you already. This is a different statistic, which basically shows, it's a bit nerdy or like maybe a bit unattractive, but basically from all the online shop sales, 50% go directly over the online shop, and 48% we have to write manual invoices for. That was a big shock, you know, because it means we spend a lot of time writing invoices. So that's, for instance, I mean, the statistic is from 2019, I think. So when we saw that, and seeing how much time we waste on bureaucracy, we kind of invested a lot of money into making a better website. So the website now can handle everything. So I think now this would look like 19 and 10 maybe. But I think we wouldn't have done it if we wouldn't have seen it like that. Yeah, then type of licenses. You know, when you use a typeface, it kind of comes down to how you use it in terms of pricing. So here, it's interesting that web licenses and print are kind of almost bought the same. Maybe this will change now, especially with the pandemic. I think a lot of new websites and stuff were produced. So maybe now there will be more web licenses sold. And then we have social media and app, which are kind of quite little. Here on the right, we can see which weights are being bought. So funny enough, or maybe no surprise, but regular is like the top seller. So bold, followed by bold and light, medium a little bit. No one really needs thin. Extra bold, also not. Yeah, it's kind of interesting. I don't know if this will influence our work, but you know, you could, I guess, get by just drawing regular. This is Vanessa, actually. She is wearing the statistics dress, color matching, in our old studio. Yeah, so she's looking at all that, and she's really good in kind of connecting the dots. And here, I explained earlier, Favorite being like a family that consists of different subfamilies. So also interestingly here, the standard is also the one that people use the most. You know, we put a lot of time into making extensions, like mono, expanded, or lining, which are really important for us and kind of complement the overall statement. But again, it's mostly the most normal thing that kind of is being purchased. That was interesting, dealing with upright and italic. So in the first two quarters of 2019, we sold mostly uprights, very little italics. And then we had the idea maybe we have to offer a bundle. Maybe italics are too expensive to buy just alone. So we kind of introduced an upright italic package. And then already in the third quarter, the sales went up. So the package is reduced in the price. So that was kind of interesting that actually, yeah, sometimes it's not only that you have to make a font, you also have to make sure that people can kind of access it, can afford it. So that was super interesting to do. That's kind of similar. We talked about white earlier. The inkjet being such a conceptual push, it still maybe is more what draws people into the store, but they leave the store with a standard version. That's kind of the sales trend of different fonts over a year. So you can see that, well, I won't explain which is which, but a couple of fonts that are really steady also almost accompany each other. So you can see there's a bit of a summer gap and so on. And then the fonts at the bottom, you can assume are mostly the crazy experimental fonts. So we have a lot of those as well, and they're usually, yeah, not big sellers, but still kind of important for our overall atmosphere. Yeah, that's the triangle that we gives title to the lecture. So I found this somewhere with like different contexts, and I think made this kind of addition. Yeah, I think as an artist or foundry or digital producer or developer, kind of have to make sure or kind of have to make your choices in terms of where on that triangle you locate yourself on. So you want to make sense, make beauty, but also make money. And that's kind of a decision on where you have to go. Yeah, then talking about font licensing a little bit. Yeah, we kind of thought font licensing is very complicated. I think it's a big topic, or we get a lot of questions, or like got a lot of questions at least. People asking, hey, I don't understand. I want to buy a font for a t-shirt. I want to buy a font for a website. What license do I need? Do I need all of them? And you know, what if my license isn't, what if my website is very new, doesn't have any traffic, but it might get a lot of traffic? How big should the license should be and so on? I don't know if you have already purchased a font license, but yeah, it's kind of complicated. So we kind of conducted a little bit of a survey on Instagram, and we kind of asked, how do you find the common process of licensing fonts? and then 1,000 people, like we cut it down to 1,000 people said, out of 1,000, 730 said, I find this tricky, and 270 said, I find this easy. And yeah, basically you can say 7 out of 10 people don't find it easy to buy something from you. Also here more the kind of emotional part maybe. How often do you feel you license the typeface correctly? You know, you did it kind of the right way, you feel good about it afterwards. Also here kind of 7 out of 10 said they don't feel like the license funds correctly. So that's also kind of bad, I would say. And then especially with web fonts, do you feel comfortable around the terms traffic, views, and clicks? There's always the language around licensing web fonts. And here it's even more drastic where, you know, 8 out of 10 people feel uncomfortable around these words. And we kind of thought we were about to like we were actually in the middle of working on our new website. And we kind of thought, okay, maybe we actually need to introduce a new licensing system, new licensing model. And we kind of had a bunch of conclusions. So no one understands licensing. I think it's easy to say. Big companies pay too little. I will explain this a bit later. And we need to make buying fonts much more simple. And we want to make fonts more affordable to students. That's kind of what we kind of concluded. And I kind of led kind of the new chapter. That's kind of last September, we launched a new website and also launched a new licensing model and a better kind of team representation. Yeah, this is one thing. Basically, you know, when you license something used-based, meaning how many computers will you install a font on, then the big company always pays less. Because the big company will say, I install a font on 3 computers. And then they walk out with a very cheap price. But a small company, which maybe only has 3 computers, let's say an artist run a studio or something like that, they will basically also maybe say, I have 1, 2, or 3 computers. So they end up paying the same price than maybe Coca-Cola would. And that's not fair. So we kind of thought the bigger the company, the bigger the price for license has to be. And the smaller the company, the smaller. And I think kind of this is fair. So our new system and works like that. Yeah, we also need to kind of, we felt the need to clarify who has to pay for a font. Because it's often that a designer sends us an email and says, ah, damn, I need to buy the font from you. I'm sorry, it's so expensive. My client doesn't want to pay. And that's totally not how it should be. Like, we think the client needs to pay the font, just the same way that the client needs to pay for web development, printing, anything like that, also for the fonts. So we kind of published this little diagram saying, Dynamo provides fonts, designer proposes fonts, and the client pays us. That's kind of how it should be, and a designer doesn't have to do negotiations on behalf of the client. Yeah, and basically here you can see a comparison between the common licensing model, most common, and our new licensing model. So on the left you can see when buying a font for different types of media, you have to select what type of media and then a lot of info that you might not know really, like how many mobile apps will you develop, how much traffic does your website get, how many domains do you have, a lot of like things that, like, for instance, small companies don't know. And for us on the right side, it's basically like this. You just have to select what do you need and then how big you are. So that's everything we need to know, and then we can kind of tell you the price. It's kind of very simple. And yeah, I think we can say that it really simplified all the conversations we had around licensing, because the client would maybe, like, it really reduced conversation about that. But also a client would now just say, okay, I employ 20 people, this is the cost, nothing more. Like, there's no more guessing or no complicated terms. Yeah, then almost the last thing. Well, really tough to speak so much. Last thing. Yeah, we wanted to give each team member a better representation, because by now we work with 6 to 7 kind of fixed team members, and then we have really a whole bunch of people around that. So we thought it would be nice to give them all on our new website their own kind of, how do you call it, like a play, like a gaming character. And we worked together with Golgotha, friends of mine who I studied with in Amsterdam. And yeah, they turned into this really crazy rendering studio, and they developed these, yeah, kind of office heroes. So you have heroes, but they all carry, you know, a thing that you would need in the office, like a pen. This one maybe not so much. Oh yeah, water canister, fruits, or here, you know, like a laser printer. And yeah, they kind of rotate, and they kind of the dynamo team. Here we have a couple more. Yeah, like metal letters, hot type, projector, like things like that. And it's really kind of close to the workshop we're doing here. Like we really talked about the story with them, kind of storyboard and the different items that each of these players would have. A couple more. Yeah, if you go to our website, you will see these in the studio section. Then we worked in general with, yo. Nice, I forgot about the sound. We worked a lot with renderings in general to also, again, kind of try different ways of showing our fonts. So Bus Group, friends from Berlin, they rendered our whole type library, like a letter each, into kind of clay from the future. So it's a bit like 3D printed, but also handmade. So on our website, you can see a lot of these letters, each characterizing like one font. Yeah, and then we launched the website, I think, September, and it was kind of a huge shift for us. So yeah, I think we had been working for 2 years on the website, and here our studio mate Dan, there's Elias actually in the back. He kind of made this cake and surprised her with the cake when it came out, which was really nice. So in Berlin, yeah, we shared a studio with a lot of different kind of creators as well. Happy day. And last thing, because we're talking at a school, we thought it would be nice to talk about that quickly. So yeah, I think it's a no-brainer, but students should have cheap access to typefaces and tools in general. So we kind of developed that created this kind of school of Dynamo kind of thing on our website, again, which is a package. So it basically, instead of you buying fonts for the original price, you can buy this like package that kind of bundles like most of our fonts. These drawings are done by our friend Nate's, and so yeah, Fabian and me supposedly. And yeah, the idea is basically a bit like in a school canteen, you know, can kind of choose this whole font menu for 1, 2, 3 euro and kind of work with these fonts during the time of your studies, and not only for your own projects, but also for your own clients. So when you buy a font from us, you can just say, I'm a student, and then you get everything also, like everything else, everything that's not in the package, you get for half the price. And that's it. I'm out of breath. Thank you for listening.
You just ask if the variable fonts will be more implemented and more featured in design software in general. So in general, this is your question. Use it After Effects because it's an animation program, and this is obvious, no? So basically, it took quite a long time for them to be actually featured in design programs like InDesign or Illustrator. So I'm pretty sure it will come to After Effects, but we're not sure. So there were like 3 years in now. We still had bugs on Safari and other browsers. So it just takes a while, I guess. So, but we hope that they will be properly able to animate type of this. So Rob is doing this animation clip that you saw. He's doing them in Drawbot, or what's that name? Drawbot? Drawbot, which is like a code-based animation program. So you have to have some workarounds for that, actually. Or you can do screen recordings in the Font Gauntlet. We didn't even mention the Font Gauntlet. We'll show tomorrow.
Yeah. We're on it, actually. Anyone else? Okay. Yeah. So the question is, when I think as a student, right? Do I have to start paying for the fonts? Like, what is a commercial use? I would say. Yeah, I think it's exactly that. I think if you enter like a commercial area where I would say you have a client, someone is paying you, I think then it's fair that that client buys the fonts. No, we looked at the triangle. You don't have to buy the fonts, but the client should have to buy the fonts. But for everything else, I think especially students, they shouldn't have to pay for fonts expensively. Like if you make your own research project and share that on Instagram or anywhere else, I think that's, for us, it would be included in the student package, basically. I think other foundries allow maybe that you can use the trials for that. But I think for me, it's more like the question if you enter kind of the commercial area with it. Yeah. Yeah, complicated. Totally. I mean, I think I can only talk for us, but like we would never chase something like that up. I think we find it super cool if students use the fonts. That's why we also like to give workshops, for instance. And I think, yeah, if you would tag us, I think you would find this cool, you know. But yeah, it's interesting to hear. I never thought about that so much, that there can be like an anxiety around that, which makes sense, I think, yeah.
And we will not immediately send a lawyer. We will probably write you a message, if anything. I mean, so you don't have to be too afraid, I guess.
But for us, in the package, for instance, because I think most of us have made also started, and I think this how it should be, make money as a student, right? Like, sell something, printed t-shirts, print posters, skateboard, running a skateboard clothing label or something like that. So in our license, it's also allowed for students to make money on their own. So if it's their own label, you know. So that was something we discussed, and I think it's quite fair, you know. But yeah, only if there's as a student, I made a website for my neighbor who was a dentist, for instance. That for me was a good job. Yeah? Got a good cleaning services after that. But that would be a commercial job, I think. Yeah. Totally. Yeah, so thanks. Yeah, that's a great question. I think, the question being, why do some foundries not all offer trial funds? I think I see a pattern. I think it's mostly old foundries or older foundries who maybe they have been in such a privileged situation for a long time, they didn't have to offer trial funds or maybe don't think it's needed. It's a bit, for me, like a kind of a top-down type of attitude, which I don't support. I also think at some point maybe they maybe can't do it. You know, like making trial funds also requires a certain type of pipeline for making that. And maybe they got a bit too heavy and they're dealing with other stuff instead. So maybe they just actually can't do this and don't wrap their heads around it really. But again, I think trial funds is a fair thing. Like you need to, especially for a luxury good like a font, I think you need to be able to test drive it and test it legally. I think, yeah, that's why we always offered it. Now we offer it also on download. I remember when we started, we really loved getting contacted also for the trial fund. So we would always send them by email one by one, which led to like really a lot of nice conversation and kind of getting to know the user a little bit. But yeah, now for us, it's also easier to just have a button and then you download the funds there. Yeah. Did it answer your question? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's it. Great. Okay. Thank you for listening. Yeah. Thanks for the live stream. Yeah.